What we're going to look at is something slightly different from what was originally in the system in Black Bull. We used to have analysing service failures, but we brought that forward to last week because I wanted to make space in the schedule for a new topic, which becomes very, very important because in the past people have kind of forgotten about it. But because you are using the Internet of Things as a source of your information for your new service, it's becoming rather more important we start thinking about how do we test our applications in ways that kind of improve the quality of the systems that we're creating and reduce the likelihood of them being modern, fractured, unreliable types of services. The sort of things that we are only too familiar with. And so it's based around a presentation I gave last week at Software Testing North in York to a whole group of professionals, test engineers, software testing engineers, and there was about 20 odd people turned up for the session. And I felt that having done the work for that, it probably would not be inappropriate to give you some insights into where the world of IT has got itself today in terms of quality of software and approaches to testing. So we're looking, as I say, at software testing in the world of big data and the Internet of Things. Now, right at the very beginning, we have to work out what is testing about. There are two forms of testing, and PMBOK Guide is a project management guide, book of knowledge. And it points out that there are two types of testing. One, verification, which proves that the software code that has been written by the coders meets the specification. But there is another version of testing which to me is even more important, validation. Does the software that has met the specification, is it capable of actually delivering what the customer actually wants, what the business actually needs? Because we can find perfectly tested software that meets the specification exactly, being of absolutely no business use because it doesn't actually meet the requirements. And this has been a problem ever since I've been involved. It's been a problem for all the time since 1953 when the first computer systems were created for business purposes. Does the delivered system meet the business requirement? And the problem is, it very, very rarely does, for a variety of reasons. Now let's have a little look at some of the context. Since 1994, an organization called the Standish Group has been producing an annual survey of the success and failure of a large number of IT projects each year. Typically 50, 60,000 are surveyed, and they normally go to the chief information officer or the director of computing to fill in the questionnaire. It's called the Chaos University Questionnaire. In 1994, they published the first ever analysis called the Chaos Report. And you can easily get a copy by going to www.standishgroup.com. And you'll see the horrifying numbers there. The blue line at the far side, 16% of systems were successful in 1994. By that, they meant on time, to budget, and delivering all of the contracted for functionality, the original system's specification. Back in those days, 31% of all IT-related projects failed. They never got implemented. And the remainder, the 53% in the green line, were what they termed challenge projects. They were late, they were over budget, and they did not deliver all of the contracted for functionality. And typically, they were 40% late, 40% over budget, and delivered about 40-50% of the functionality. Now, bearing in by that time, there were people who were running IT projects were already applying the Pareto principle of choosing the 20% of functionality that delivered 80% of the task that was being done, and then threw away the rest, the 80% of functionality. So you ended up with 20% functionality that customers, the users, were used to using, and then for a challenge project, you were delivering about 40% of that, which means you're giving them 8% of the functionality, the business functionality that they were used to using. It does not meet the business needs. And you can see how over a period of time, the success rate of projects slowly inched up to 32, 37, 39% of all projects were on time to budget and delivering the contracted for functionality. And the level of failures dropped down to 17-18%, which is getting quite a lot better. And the challenge kind of reduced as you increase the successful ones. But during this period, a lot of chief information officers, a lot of business managers would say, hang on, yeah, if your development cycle is 3, 4, 5 years long using the waterfall process, how on earth can you expect me to be keeping the specification constant when the world is changing, this world of globalization, and everything's changing faster and faster and faster? So Standish Group effectively said to them, okay, what do you want us to say? What's the question, guys? So they came up with a new question, which you can see, which was in 2013, and they then retrospectively reevaluated back to 2011 and 2012. Because the CIOs and business people said, well, on time to budget, yeah, I'm quite happy with. But I'd like to have it as, did it deliver business value? So no longer all of those functionality from 3-4 years ago, but does it give me value today? Now, as you can see, there's a very, very counterintuitive result. By switching the definition, which the business people thought would move the success rate up to, say, there, it actually reduces it by 12%. So we're not delivering, although we may be on time to budget, the actual business value that our systems are delivering is worse than ever. And this is really very, very intriguing. I don't fully understand why that drop has happened, but very clearly, as the CIOs are looking at their systems, they're saying, oh, this is challenged because it doesn't deliver enough value for the business. Now, in some sort of areas, you might expect that we will learn from the past. We will learn from our mistakes. We will learn from our failures. People continuously say, if we don't read history, we are condemned to repeat history. So what is happening? Why are we still running at about 30% of properly, truly successful project in IT? Value creation. Everybody looks on IT and business as a way of creating value for the business, for the shareholders, for society, and on and on. Across the world, broadly speaking, we spend something like $3 to $3.5 trillion US dollars on information systems, technology, and communication technologies. out of a global gross domestic product of something like $60 to $70 trillion. So we're looking at something close to 5-6% of global GDP is spent on our profession, computing, communications, and all of that sort of stuff. New systems, running systems, buying software, and everything else that's covered in the ICT budget, GDP of $3 odd trillion. However, if we go back, clearly all the money spent on these failed projects is money completely wasted. It delivers absolutely no value other than a bit of employment. And that's all it does. Doesn't give value to the organisations that are spending money on it. All of this stuff up here, the challenged over budget, late, delivering 40-50% of the functionality expected, doesn't deliver value. And people then have to use workarounds. They have to spend a lot of time sort of recording the data or waiting until it happens and so on. So we can easily add up that much money and that much money. So let's be trivial. Only 30% of that, the new spend on ICT delivers reasonable value, about $1 trillion. That may be an overstatement because we don't spend $1 trillion necessarily on developing and installing new systems, perhaps. There's data out there that you could go and research to find out what the balance really is. But different people have looked at what is the cost or the lost value caused by all of this global industry on ICT. And the cost of IT failures, depending who you talk to, who's done the modelling and what they've included in their models, suggests that the world of IT costs the world somewhere between $500 billion and $6 trillion. In other words, twice the amount of money that we actually spend on it. If that top end really is correct, and it includes a lot of assumptions about how much it costs us to do things because the IT doesn't work right, that's twice what we spend on IT. It's 10% roughly of world GDP. If that is the case, the industry we have chosen to follow is the most value-destructive industry in the world, bar none. Even worse than financial services, which in the credit crunch wiped out a few $1 trillion. But we do it every single year, and we have done it for the last nearly 20 years. So that's a kind of rather frightening, rather scary background to why we need to think about both verifying and validating our systems more effectively. And we are lousy at doing it. Just as a trivial thought, think about generally over the last couple of years or so, various organisations have managed to lose close on 1 billion sets of personal data every year. How many of you saw last week about Yahoo? How many sets of data do you think they've managed to lose? 500 million in 2014, and possibly another 200 million in 2012. There seems to be different stories that would suggest there are two incidents, and maybe they didn't even know about the 2012 one until they're investigating 2014 and the guy blogged about his two. So that's possibly Yahoo have lost 700 million. Multiplied by $200 per lost set. So just the 500 million times 2 is 1 billion. It's about 200 billion, $100 billion.
And that's assuming that the details they have don't lead to other personal details getting.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, basically, this is the average cost here across the industry of how much it costs the world, the individual, and other people to reissue cards, reissue passwords, consequential losses of hacking and so on. But yeah. So when Target lost 75 million sets of data, they had to lots of companies had to reissue credit cards and. So add that all up. That 500 billion is a very, very low estimate, I reckon. So it's somewhere in the trillions of dollars, $1 or $2 trillion. It might be as high as $6 trillion. What other industry can match that for destroying value? Causing upset, causing problems for huge numbers of people.
Banking,
the banking industry has problems. We now know that the lovely chipped cards are no longer secure. They're easy to crack now. There's all sorts of, and if you have your contactless, those are lethal. They can be read by a suitably beefed up scanner at 2-3 feet, not the 3 or 4 inches that they're supposed to do. There's an experiment done about 2 years ago, according to some police who've talked to our staff here last year, and they just walked past a queue at a checkout and nicked 400 quid from every single person, 20 people in the queue. What the message is, I haven't done it yet, but line your wallet with some silver foil or something, or get a Faraday caged wallet. If you've got a passport, if you travel a lot, it's probably a good idea to, again, put it into a Faraday cage wallet. Because all of these RFID chips are now readable, and we now know these contactless cards are easy to read, easy to crack, and the chip and pin is also beginning to be broken. Because whatever humans invent, the criminals will crack. So those numbers are going to increase, the costs are going to increase, the value destruction will increase unless we do some interesting things. Some of you already started looking at Lascad, Denver International, Heathrow Terminal 5. We haven't looked at the Egg company. Do you remember, heard of Egg? An online bank. I forget who it got bought up by eventually. but when they first went live, back in 2003 or thereabouts, they were the first online banking thing. Advertised heavily, and part of the advertising was, if you sign up in the first day or so, you will get a 100 quid bonus. And the predictable result was, in 45 minutes, what happened, do you reckon? It went down. The whole system just went down. They hadn't thought about the loads that they were going to get, how many people were going to pour in onto the system, and they hadn't thought about having any load shedding mechanisms on the inbound routers and switches, and they hadn't got enough server capacity. Collapsed. Lot of embarrassment. Took about a week or two, and I forget the precise detail, you go find out if you're interested. And they beefed up their whole environment, put some load shedding capacity mechanisms in, and went back live again a week or two later. Very, very embarrassing.
They were bought by
Was it Yorkshire Bank?
Yeah.
It was, right? What was even more embarrassing, 2 or 3 years later, down in London, there's an organisation that hold all the records for births, deaths and marriages since time immemorial, virtually here. And they decided to go online so that all these sort of genealogists, your uncle and aunt who wants to find out the family tree, could get online. Again, a lot of advertising. On the day it was switched on, it went down after about 45, 50 minutes. Just like Egg. Haven't learned the lesson. Bit of a hunt around for some more server capacity, load shedding capacity. Oh, and they also then said, when you log in, you have 15 minutes before we will auto log you out and you won't better get back in for a while. So as to share the capacity. Hadn't learned, even 2 or 3 years later, against what was one of the most spectacular and well-reported failures in sort of British media. We all know about operating system upgrades. Did anybody of you pick up the iOS 10 within 2 days of it being released. Anybody? No, we don't do that. Oh, you were successful, weren't you, Winnie? You were lucky. But most of us don't. We know to wait until 10.1 or 10.2 comes out. We learned that with Windows 95, XP, Vista, and so on. We knew to wait until Service Pack 1 or perhaps even Service Pack 2 came out before we updated. We know it's not adequately tested. And with iOS, it's getting worse and worse because there are so many different devices out there. I mean, at least my iPad won't update to it because it's too old. So I'm not being irritated all the time, but do you want to be updated now? Have I introduced you guys to Night Capital, or is that fine? Yeah, we've talked about Night Capital and the magical ability to burn through $450 million in 45 minutes. No one's ever done that before, and hopefully no one will do it again. And it was so simple. One out of eight servers wasn't properly updated with the new software, and it read the message wrongly and did the wrong thing. Most of you know about the Derby Kingsway roundabout, when they built this beautiful new roundabout, much bigger, with lots of lovely traffic lights around it so that people could walk, pedestrians could get across it, and to control the flow in and out of the retail centre. Do you remember what happened? How many of you were there when they switched it on and the whole of that area got gridlocked? People were locked in the retail park for 2 hours and some, trying to get out. The algorithms weren't correct. They hadn't properly tested it in the simulation, and now they switched them off. You never see a queue there. It's beautiful, the traffic flows in and out. The topology of the roundabout solved the problem, not the traffic lights, which caused a problem. We know about the security failures on almost every platform there is. Almost every system. And then we know about, in terms of autonomous cars and other such things, you know, remember Top Gear? Jeremy Clarkson stands in front of the car and says, this one's going, it's got proper avoidance, and as long as Richard's driving it, not too fast, it'll stop. And then you've seen the lovely pictures of Clarkson having to leap sideways very, very quickly. Remember those?
Yeah.
And then there's one with, I forget what it was, a nice high-end something or other, and they were driving into something big, and it was going to miss, going to run into this concrete or avoid the concrete, and it went... And the Google and Tesla cars and the various types of accidents that they've had. Yeah, and it actually gets more and more interesting if you look at how these cars are learning about things and what they don't learn. I mean, one of the Google cars had a problem because, I don't know if you know, but before a Google car is allowed to go onto a set of roads, another Google car has gone along with some stunning lasers and etc. to survey the road to it within about 5 millimetres or 5 or 10 millimetres, the width, where all the white lines are, where the edges are, the heights of the curbs to within that much, and. And one of them, the one that got crunched by a bus, got a bit confused because someone was doing some road work, so there's some cones and bags of sand and so on along that side, so it didn't know where the edge of the road was anymore, which is kind of sad. Or the Tesla car that couldn't see the lorry that was beside it because it was white. And these guys are saying our clever super wizard machinery with all their learning algorithms, machine learning, and, are going to be safer than humans. Really? An interesting thought. Because if they are actually actively learning in ways that we cannot prove, and I should talk about this in a little bit, they continue to learn, which is what we do, rather than having fixed, proven algorithms, they will become, I suspect, as unreliable as humans over time. Some interesting aspects, sorry. Now, if we look at all those failures and many other failures of the sort that you're looking for in your research, a at the moment in the module. These are a list of some of the themes of why software fails, why systems fail. And what I haven't included here is an appropriate understanding of the relationship between the human and the machine and how we do or don't work effectively. But one of the very, very significant ones is we are incapable, for a variety of reasons, of creating 100% perfect specification. Now, that depends fundamentally on human memory. Because if I am a business analyst or a systems analyst and come to you as a customer asking about what is it you want me to do with the system, you have to be able to tell me every last single thing. Otherwise, I cannot give you a perfect spec. So we have a fundamental problem of human memory. We can't actually get that perfect specification. So we have a problem that what you are using or you want to use and what I write down as your specification will be wrong. There will be a difference. And I learned my lesson on that one when I was not very much older than you guys, just after I graduated, so I was probably about 23. And I was being released into the manufacturing systems at Rolls-Royce, onto the purchase systems, the procurement systems. And as part of the development that I went through was, rather than specifying new systems at that stage, here is one or two sort of relatively small changes that are needed to the software. So Richard, go off and talk to those guys over there in the purchase office because they need something changing. So I duly toddle off, listen to the three or four managers and other experts who defined what this change was. I carefully recorded it, got it typed up, went back to see them, said, look, this is my draft based on what you said. Is it correct? And they would go through and say, yeah, that's okay, Richard, that's what we want. So I then took it to the programmers, the guys who actually built the system several years earlier and had been looking after it and maintaining it and changing it over time. Gave it to them. Something like about a week later, I went in there to see how things were going, and one of the guys said, Richard, come over here. Yup. This spec, Richard, this mod spec, it's wrong. Why? Well, it's based on a misunderstanding of what the system already does and what changes are needed to make it do what the customer actually wants. Because the customers who were asking me to write that down a modification request hadn't fully understood what was actually happening. So there was a mismatch. Fortunately, because they were the team who created and maintained the system, they knew exactly what the context was, what was required. They knew the guys, because they saw some of these purchase guys fairly regularly. So they had a good idea as to what was required. Now, if I had sent that spec to a subcontractor who was just producing that modification or offshore outsourced, I would have got the mod back, software code, doing exactly what the mod said, and it would have broken the system big time. But they had the context and knowledge. Another area we have is missing features and needs, and one of the biggest areas we see, like with Yahoo and Target and many, many others, is security. The security failures are a whole range of mixture of factors, from operating system update, critical system updates, and failure to build security into the specification from day one. It's one of those irritating, rather expensive things called non-functional requirements, which everybody tries to avoid until the last possible moment, at which point it becomes very difficult to fix and hugely expensive. We also see a lot of problems at the unit tests, the integration testing area, and even if we get through that, when we do user acceptance tests, that is when we find the mismatch between needs and specification. And often it's because things aren't remembered at earlier stages. We also have some magical aspects when we start trying to assess whether the system's fast enough to do what it's supposed to do. And one example was with the Child Support Agency's project a few years ago, when they managed to design a new system which, when they went live, took 3 times longer than the old process that they were trying to speed up. A lot of organisations with big systems like SAP and PeopleSoft, the big ERP systems, will do the development work on relatively small server environments with relatively small amounts of data. And I know of an organisation where they'd done that, they'd then, to try and make sure that the workloads were sort of apparently reasonable, they then got the entire 600-strong project team spread around the company at a point in time in the day, a nominated time, to fire up a particular transaction and press it as quickly as they could do to see what happened. And they thought that was solving the problem. However, they were working with relatively small numbers of people. They want to scale it to 6,000 users. They wanted to be sure that at all times it would do the right thing. And it seemed to in the unit testing, their integration testing, and so on. And then they went live. 2 days, 2 weeks later, 2 weekends later, they then triggered the first materials resource planning cycle, which created something like 50 million new records in what had been an empty table that had been tested with a few hundred or a few thousand records during testing. And on the first Monday after that event, everybody came in. It started working perfectly normally, 2-3 second response time as per normal. And then it stopped working for half an hour. Then it came back for a few minutes, normal response. Then it stopped for another 30 minutes. And it had a couple of three of those. And then they finally worked out which transaction was causing that problem. During the investigation over the next 3 or 4 days before they finally sorted out what it was, it turned out that a particular transaction which ran on this new 50 million record table had had a slight change, only a tiny little change, from searching on this column to that column. Now, this column was the one that SAP had set it up with. This column was the one that the organization needed for their purposes. And someone, didn't matter who, had forgotten to check whether the new column had been indexed properly in the database. And it wasn't, because they'd kind of forgotten. And so the poor server, I mean, you're talking about some of the largest Unix servers in the world at that time. It was having to read through 50 million records to find the one transaction that guy was looking for. And it took half an hour of trundling up, loading in, reading the database or the table, row by row, chunk by chunk, until it had gone all the way down to find where was that row. And that took half an hour. Because they'd done it on, when they're doing the unit testing and integration testing, they've got a few hundred records, maybe a few thousand records, all nicely in memory. So it didn't matter whether it was or wasn't indexed, you found it very, very quickly with a sequential search. When you have 50 million records, you can't fit that table in core. You start reading it. You really want to be able to just read the one row. Didn't find it until too late. Often we have the wrong sort of data. We use constructed data. And because we use constructed data, the users who are doing testing can't work out whether it's right or wrong. You want to get good user testing, you use real data because they know what it means. They know what it should do. Machine learning and AI systems, many of them, it's very, very difficult to find out what they've actually learned. How many systems, particularly on smart devices, even on PC ones on the web, how many times do things not turn up in the right place to make it difficult for you to actually work out what you need to do? You can't find the right button. They've hidden it at the bottom somewhere down there, or it's somewhere off, far off to the right, and you've got to scroll across. The human-computer interface factors. The things that Dennis Parks is really passionate about and really experienced about, that he's teaching you about in IT product development, and taught you last year in whatever the module was last year. Was it IT design or something?
Yeah.
These are things that people forget. It all leads also to the fact that we have this situation where almost every single piece of software is never at a production standard. It's, crumbs, if there's something wrong, we'll catch it in a month's time with the next update or the next download. I've got about 21 updates on 30-odd apps waiting to be installed. In fact, one of them today just said, it's expired. You better go to the iTunes and get the latest version. That's a new one. I've not had that one on me before. Now, a little reminder. Here is a rather simplified version of the waterfall. And even if you use the Agile or the new technology called DevOps, which is combining development straight into operation and so on, you still have to work out what the need is, the design, the architecture. You've got to think about data, about the hardware. In the world of big data and Internet of Things, you start having to think about what data. You produce a bit of code, you do a bit of testing, and maybe you go back to the beginning if you're really into the prototyping environment. Someday, sometime, you get to release it out into the wild, into the big wide world of production releases, and then you discover volume data and real data. The real messy data that's there, rather than the nicely constructed test data which meets all the expected conventions. And then you repeat it and go back to the beginning or halfway and. Slightly cynical but simplified, but it gives a message of some what's going on. Now, how do we find out problems? Well, if we're looking at the code compared to spec, then we do verification. The more challenging part is the validation of what comes out at the back end of this process to what's really needed. With the size and scale of modern software, and particularly the software that uses lots of APIs to sort of reach out and get stuff, it actually becomes questionable whether we can actually do total comprehensive verification of every possible path through the software. What about validation? Does it do what it's meant to do, what needs to do? We've got uncertain and probably incomplete requirements, and may even be incorrect. So those who are using these new agile prototyping DevOps types of processes, where there is no spec possibly, it's even more exciting. So that's traditional sort of systems development. Lots of problems. Now let's add in big data and the Internet of Things. Does it make life even more interesting or does it make it simpler? Let's find out. We all know the nature of big data. It's high volume, high velocity, and lots of variety. Those are the three V's from 2002. I think it was Gartner came up with them. As the definition, the volume and velocity greater than we know how to cope with. So kind of puts the big data always a little bit out of reach. But IBM a little bit later added in value as well. Now, we know how information is growing in terms of Instagram, in terms of Twitter and YouTube. You know, we've got, 100 hours of YouTube per minute of existence is being loaded, something like that. But did you know that jet engines like the Trent engine there on a 787, a Boeing 787, produces around about a terabyte of data a day that is streamed back to London, to Derby often, and to be looked at by the engineers here in Derby. Or those Formula One cars. We know how instrumented that they are, but did you realize there's up to 800 sensors just on the floor of a Formula One car? But if there's 800 on the floor, how many more are there? There's, you know, they're producing terabytes of data during a race as well. That gives you a bit of an idea about the speed of creating data. And the Google car, huge amounts of data about where everything is that it's trying to navigate. And that lot costs about $170,000 for that thingy on the top plus the control systems. Which raises a little question, verification and validation of what's going on in a combined Google system. Because they do most of the processing actually in a huge server farm to work out where all the bits of the road are, and then try and reduce the processing load in here so it just knows where it is in relation to the map that it has of that fantastic 10 millimeter accuracy. So they're not relying on GPS at all. Are you vanishing for the rest of the evening?
No,
okay. So we need to start thinking outside of our nice little tiny areas that professionals work in. We need to think much more broadly about the whole of the system that we're trying to do. And that includes the people, as well as the software, as well as the hardware, the networks, and so on. We need to start thinking more carefully as a profession, and that's you guys particularly in BSCIT, to think about how we capture requirements more effectively, taking account of human lack of memory or failures of memory. If you go back 15 years and more, we were always ever so clear about functional and non-functional requirements. Do you remember, have you come across that yet? What is a functional requirement? It's essentially the algorithms, the thing that the software must do in terms of processing data and making it giving advice, perhaps. The non-functional are those things which don't relate to how the software operates, but kind of control it. Things like the HCI, the interfaces, like security. Security by design, perhaps. And the other one is, out of the work that Standish Group have done, and it was, if you look at the notes, and I'll publish the PDF of this later on today, the presentation is there. If you look at the notes section, you'll see the date at which Standish Group pointed out that the successful projects were those where the project sponsor had doubled the project budget and added another 40%. And done that to other parts of the timescale as well. And then project managed like crazy, and they were like just about likely to be successful. But most IT-related projects today, the sponsors, you hear this indrawn hiss of breath, you know, like the plumber, and said, oh, that's far too expensive, not 30% of the budget, of the timescale, of the resources, and I'll authorise it. I'll give you a challenging target. Every one of those projects will, almost without fail, become challenged or failed projects. They will not be successful. And interestingly, where you see such things happen, and sometimes you do get a kind of successful project that at least delivers what's required, very often, the actual cost and timescale will be the original estimate, not the 30% less one. I've seen those in my life as well. So these are up there for the professionals, for businesses, to understand how real things happen. And as Daniel Kahneman says in his book, Thinking Fast and Slow, he points out that the fallacy of optimism is endemic in almost every type of project, whether it's construction or IT or almost any other one. And people don't actually think about what has happened in the past. What do we know about success? And the Standish Group reports are a fantastic resource that tells us a lot about how you get successful projects, and conversely, how you get these challenged and failed projects. And yet, so many executive-sponsored projects say, yeah, it might be in the past, but we're going to be successful this time without any evidence or anything in place to help them become successful. So we've got the most value-destructive industry in the world. We've got causes for that being to do with perhaps our inability to get good requirement specifications or to ferret out the best one, the correct ones, and our inability to test software effectively, and. So let's look at project governance. We'll cover this more in the third year, but we'll just bring in a few bits now that'll help you understand what you need to build into your assignment. A rather simplistic version of governance is doing the right thing in the right way, at the right time, with the right resources, the right quality, in the right place, for the right reasons, and, as far as you want to go. Kind of what governance is really all about. So if we have that in the back of our minds, then we need to think about what do we have to do in terms of IT projects or IT service development projects, which is what you're about, to get a successful piece of software out there using some set of data. These are all the areas that we've got to get right. We've got to check on as we go through our designs and so on. We've got to validate against all of those and then verify against all of those. In simple terms, what needs to be done. If we are to be successful, it might be expensive, it might take time. But if we are busy destroying twice as much value as we spend on IT, kind of a good idea to take a new look at what we're doing as a profession. And you're going to be out there in a couple of years' time, well, 1 year, next year, for many of you in your placement, and then couple of years later in your jobs, and you're going to be out there thinking about why are all of the projects I work on challenged? Here's some thoughts. Now, a couple of years ago, 3 years ago, third year students in the final semester were doing enterprise systems or information security and assurance. And we were starting to look at big data and SMEs and so on. And we started off with the traditional three V's that define big data, and then started thinking, well, they don't have to stop at defining it. We can turn it around as a set of questions for governance, getting things right. But ultimately, governance is about asking the right questions in the right context to begin to understand what your project is really all about. The traditional ones here came up in about 2002, and I think it was from Gartner, and then a year or so later, IBM added in the V for value as a question. And then, so we're sort of looking at the assignments for ESA and ISA, ISA and ESA, ES, and can we extend this as a further set of questions that can help doing governance? And we were kind of reassured that this was a good idea, because ISO 27002, which is defined as the international standard for information security and information governance, has in 27002 a fantastic set of questions about all sorts of aspects of information security and information governance. So the idea of using a framework as a set of questions is validated by the use of ISO 27002. So we thought, let's see if we can find out some other words beginning with V to be the V's of big data. And now it turns out we can start using them as the V's of information governance and system development. Because each of these V words is asking you to ask interesting questions about different aspects of the data, the network, the hardware, the software, the users, the sponsors, and so on, the whole project, that will lead you to be able to be certain, A, that the project has a chance of delivering value and being successful, and you can start avoiding some of the big pitfalls that otherwise you will fall into. You can see at the bottom link There's a short presentation there that goes through each of the V's in a bit more detail. I just want to very briefly look at four of them, because in the world of IoT and big data, some of these questions become important. Value, yeah, what's the value of the project? Well, you kind of get at that in your project launch with a bit of luck. But you can also find out, ask that in terms of who is going to get value. Is it going to be the user? Is it going to be in pound notes, or is it in usability that makes them more valuable customers because they keep coming back to you because it's easy to do what they want to do? Or is the HCI so bad, or the system performance so bad, that they go away in 3 seconds because it's not responsive? You can also use the word V for value against your data. Is that data really valuable? Are you just jumping on a bandwagon to use Twitter or Facebook or social media just because everybody else around you claims they're doing it? Is it really valuable? Vulnerability, yeah, things like security. We all know about security vulnerability. We keep hearing about it. But what about reputational vulnerability? When Target lost those 75 million sets of ID and it became publicly known, their share value dropped through the floor. Lost about 30 or 40% value almost overnight. Think about what happened with, was it TalkTalk who lost half a million this year, whatever? Most of those customers have not gone back to them. They've gone elsewhere. And it takes a lot of effort to rebuild a reputation. And, you know, there are consequences of systematic and systemic errors and failures in your systems. You lose customers. You may lose suppliers. You may lose certification, which allows you to trade with other people. V for velocity, how quickly is the data coming at you and how quickly do you need to process it? Two different questions. Ask them explicitly and you will learn. In other words, do you have to process the data in real time or can you catch up later on with specific inquiries rather than just processing the whole lot? Because that then changes your infrastructure requirements in terms of bandwidth, in terms of number of servers or switches, and. Volatility and variability are slightly different. Volatility kind of gets has the sort of implication of how long does that data live for before it expires and becomes irrelevant. Variability is, does that person who is tweeting or posting or liking or disliking have a constant, every time they come back to that type of thing, they post in the same way, they respond the same way, or are we random? And it's a mixture. So volatility is, I know it's valid then, but is it only applicable for the next couple of days, couple of seconds? Whereas variability is just the inherent changes in the way we look at things and make decisions and make judgments. So does all this mean that with big data, we need to do different things, new things, with our testing? And the answer is clearly yes. If you have got lots and lots of data which is of uncertain veracity, and as John Easton said in 2012, 80% of all of the data we have around us, and particularly that which is big data and from the Internet of Things, is of uncertain veracity. We do not know whether the data is right or wrong, and for those data that are wrong, we do not know by how much the data is incorrect either. And as we move into the world of sensor networks, we move into the world of, say, GPS locations based on these, if we have a single reading off here, we have absolutely no idea how accurate it is. If we've got half a dozen, then we can identify the startup errors, and I've got one set on, off here, where the first one was 1,800 kilometers or miles in error, and then the next four, within the next 10, 15, 20 seconds, were about right. So can we, and then if you do get time sequences, and we got some data from Microsoft China called GeoLife data series, and there's about 1.5 gigabytes of data there. Those are of individual journeys around China and different places. And even in a sequence, if you take a reading on one of these every 5 seconds as you go walk around town, most of those will be about right within plus or minus 5-10 meters. But there are going to be readings in that time sequence or time series which are out by 10, 20, 50, 100 meters quite easily. How do you detect those? So what we need to do with IoT sort of stuff is start thinking about single reading error detection and also time series anomaly detection. If you're looking at some of those sets of data in from all sorts of data where sensor networks are involved, whether it's in transport, whether it's in farming, agriculture, aviation, banking, every field where there are sensors, smart cities, smart buildings, sensors don't necessarily retain their calibration very well. If it's on off, it's kind of not difficult. If it's doing a proportional one, then you probably need to think about testing for sensor calibration and checking where that's happening. And then there's lots of other things. The bottom one, multi-source data integrations, typically for businesses, they will have a master data set, perhaps of all of their customers. Banks like doing this. They know each of us by name and by various numbers. But what they want to try and do is to connect us in their master data sets to data feeds from social networks, from the various credit rating companies and so on, and try and connect up the Richard self in their data with the Richard selves out there so they get a bigger, more full picture. That can be fraught with difficulty. And in each language, there are sets of names which are more popular than any. And in English, it's John Smith. And John Smith is a problem for banks and many others. Another area that's really fun for big business, and we see it with platforms like SaaS and all the other big analytics platforms used inside a business, is where they're trying to get a complete picture across the whole business with systems which are built in the traditional silo. This is manufacturing, this is marketing, this is sales, this is engineering, this is accounting. And trying to connect across all of those can become remarkably difficult, because you will find fields in your databases and the table definitions that appear to be the same. Until you investigate, not the data dictionary itself, the computerized version, but you go and talk to the experts who know that data, the domain experts, and they will start explaining that in this silo, this field with this name means this. And over here, another domain expert says, yeah, I know it says the same, has the same field name as over there, but we have a slightly different meaning, which means you can't actually connect, link together on that field name and get a table-based join, or database table join on that. You can do it because they've got identical values, but they mean different things in business terms. So there's all sorts of interesting things in terms of checking whether the data is real, whether the veracity is certain or not. Machine learning is becoming really fascinating. If you look at the traditional AI and traditional machine learning, it's using all sorts of types of correlation, some of them are using things like neural networks, where you've got different layers of software that do different things and connect together. There are a couple of really interesting things going on about how this works, about the training data, for example. And there's a beautiful example for machine vision, back from, I think, just before the turn of the century, maybe just after. Machine vision can, and this is military one, is it possible to teach a computer to distinguish between photos of friendly tanks and enemy tanks? So they collected a huge stack of photos of each sort, and kept presenting pairs to the machine to say, is this, or a single one, is this friendly or is this enemy? And after a while, it seemed to be working a treat. They then used a few more of the same sets of photos to check whether it was working correctly, ones that it hadn't seen, so this was a test data. And they thought they'd won, until someone had the idea, well, let's find out, these are all rather similar. Let's see if we got some more photos from this angle or something, in different situations, does it work? And it was only then that they discovered what the vision system had actually learned. It had learned nothing about tanks or the shapes of tanks. What it had learned was a much more important aspect of each of the sets of photos was that the enemy ones were in forest and wooded sort of scenes, so it could detect woods and forests beautifully, and it could detect sunny deserts perfectly. And it had ignored all aspects of tanks in there. So it had learned to detect the difference between a forest and a desert, which to humans is trivially simple. And the same is going if you start looking into the neural network-based learning. It is unbelievably difficult, very nearly impossible, to tell what the neural network has actually learned at all. All you can tell is, if I give it this, it will tell me something like this. So if you have got a neural network algorithm for following the edge of the road, do you know whether it's really learned where the edge of the road is, or is it just learned that there's somewhere over there, somewhere, a sort of edge of something? It might be a verge, or it might be the edge of Loch Lomond if you're driving up the edge of Loch Lomond. And it might be just learning where the edge of the water is, rather than where the edge of the road is. Who knows? Gets very, very difficult to prove. One of the things about the training process, if you look at SAS, for example, they have a beautiful, really beautiful piece of software called the Model Factory. And you tip a huge amount, say 3 months' worth of real-life data into it, and tell it to produce the various correlation models that you can perhaps use as your decision-making or advisory systems for your help desks, call centers, and so on. And it will take all that data and run all sorts of different algorithms, predictive algorithms against that, and come up with, this is my recommendation, this is the best fit. And if you have decided to feed it one or two that you want to specifically have a look at, it'll have a look at those as well. And it will rate them all, yeah, this is a great one, and then down to, I really don't understand the output from this one, I think you need to go and have a look at it yourself. You choose the best one, and then you release that into production for all and sundry to use as their advisory system for the next 3 months. Then you take the next 3 months' worth of data, shove it through the factory again, and see how your models or the algorithms are kind of tweaked to reflect what happened last 3 months based on the decision-making algorithm you're using during that time. And you change that, perhaps, to a new one. And that has some interesting questions. Is that the recommendation process may then change from the last 3 months to the next 3 months because you've got a new algorithm. And that means you're making different decisions for the same, precisely the same set of data that was used but maybe have been given by a customer last month, next month, and coming up with potentially different recommendations and decisions. That has an interesting, potentially legal and reputational impact. And I don't think businesses have started to cotton on to that. I mean, I heard that the presentation about how the Model Factory works and how brilliant it is. SAS User Forum, Global User Forum, I think it was either last year or this year, this is what we do, guys. And it hadn't really struck me until I was putting this presentation together that what are the governance consequences? Again, there are other interesting things about the Agile methodology, how it was originally designed without any, almost any documentation anywhere, except perhaps a little statement of needs, mostly done with co-located users on the project team sitting there together while they delivered bits and pieces and developed it. The integrated user involvement. Today, Agile is becoming much more heavyweight, much more paperwork, and actually in reality, in the financial services, you have to have some pretty heavyweight documentation to make sure you're meeting the regulatory compliance aspects. Those are fundamentally critical. And what we're finding now, and I asked the guys up at Software Testing North, you're all the testing, software testing engineers and experts. When do you see your users in this Agile or DevOps environment? And the response came back almost along the lines of, what's a user? They haven't seen them. They're not co-located. They never go and see what the dev team are doing. So how can you be agile if you haven't got the users there? And then another part of the incremental delivery of functionality is that although Parnas's principle, which states that objects of software only communicate through the defined boundary and the interface that's there, it turns out that in a lot of programming dev shops, the programmers apply the principle to themselves. They do not talk to their colleagues. They do not talk about what's going on in that object versus this object, or this part of the system versus that part of the system. That's part of the spec. And so a lot of problems don't get found until much later on in the process. And if you haven't got much of a spec, and you think about most of the apps that come out on here, the vast majority of the apps on smart devices, whether it's Android, iOS, or Windows, are written by individuals, not by companies and big organizations. How many of the apps on here would you reckon, I don't know the answer, but how many are likely to have a formal requirement spec written down by the person? Any? Any formal detailed specification? Any formal recognition of the importance of security? Think about all those games, online games platform from the biggest companies in the world. When did they start thinking about security? After they'd had a hack. But a proper think about it anyway. So when does all the validation happen? Does it happen? Can it happen? Where is validation all the way through the process? It isn't there. So in terms of the assignment that you've got to think about, one of the big things I'm going to be looking for in terms of delivering value, measuring value, will be all the way through the article, is that you refer back to verification and validation. Validation of the requirement is met, verification that the thing is done right. Because one last thing about big analytics platforms, test engineers' principles and methodologies very rarely are seen in the analytics and data science teams. So people using SAS or Watson Analytics or all these other platforms that you're getting to know, the data scientists and the analytics experts do it all. And don't really understand the proper methodologies for software testing. And there's an example from one of the guys there I was talking to. And they've got some statisticians or whatever the engineering stuff they were doing. And they got lots of data which happened to be human safety critical. And they realized that, oh, we could hack together a little system that will analyze this data and make some recommendations. Hey, this is going to be real valuable for our clients, our customers. And they sort of hacked some software together, no requirement spec anywhere in sight, did some stuff and they, oh wow, this is brilliant, this is real cool, we've got to take it to the chief exec. So they took this thing to the chief exec, who thought, wow, this is brilliant. Yeah, I'm getting ready to package up and we'll get it out there as soon as possible. At which point, fortuitously and fortunately, the formal software testing people were called in to have a look before it went out. And in very short order, they discovered that the guys hacking the code together, and whether they're using Python or R or Java or whatever, they'd made some very silly algorithmic errors, so that the recommendation or the analysis was completely dependent on the sequence of data being fed into it, when it should not have been. It should have been independent of sequence. So if you turn the data set around, just say it came in early to latest, and you put it in latest to earliest, it gave a different answer. Now that was found by the software test engineers just very quickly. It could be fixed. And I have no evidence at the moment. I'll be testing it out again in a couple of 3 weeks' time down another conference in London, as to whether this problem of lack of test methodologies in analytics and data science is as pervasive as I currently fear it is. But that's another area. It's a new area. I mean, it was interesting at Rolls-Royce 18 years ago, something like that. That the procurement organization, if you look at most businesses, they have a specialist procurement organization for IT. They have the ordinary, all the normal office supplies and buildings and so on over there. And then inside computing, we have our little group of procurement experts who are procurement experts in software. And you think, hang on, how much is there that's really fundamentally different in principle between that procurement and this procurement, apart from a bit of complexity, a little bit of domain aspect? But do you really need to have a group over there totally isolated from over there? And we see the same happening now in sort of testing. Mainstream, Java and so on, of course we've got to have software test engineers, but this BI analytics-y sort of stuff, I don't think we need it. We know what we're doing, we're analytics experts. We know how to use R and Java or Python and SAS and Watson and. Why should we bother about the formality of testing? So, think on that, guys. On which note, any questions?